ಸೌಂಡ್ ಚೇಕ ಮಾತಾಡಬಾರದು. Good morning students, I welcome for the zoology session today. Okay, today we have a speaker, Miss Jansi Bai. She is PGT zoology from Munipalli from Sangareddy districts. She has master's degrees and BEd, and she worked as assistant professor in various engineering colleges and also a science teacher in international schools. Now let us welcome Miss Jansi. Today's session is about human anatomy and physiology, and she'll be giving introduction for the excretory system. Yes, I welcome Jansi ma'am to take over.
Vijayalakshmi ma'am, good morning. Thank you for your very warm welcome and a warm introduction. TSMS team, respected principals, respected coordinators, friends, colleagues, dear students and viewers, a very good morning to all of you. Friends, how are you all? Students, I'm sure how you could be spending your time lazing around, some of you missing your friends, some of you missing your school, your college, some of you finding good time to be at home. But I should say that you should really be utilizing the time that is given to you and the lessons that are presented to you. As in the previous session, sir was sharing, we really are working hard to see that you learn without wasting time. So this is for you, dear friends. So please don't waste time and try to learn, try to concentrate. I would like to start off first with a thank you note. My sincere and heartfelt thanks to our AD sir, AD Satyanarayana Reddy Garu, for providing us this opportunity. I also would like to thank my coordinator, principal of Telangana Model School, Narsapur, Vijayalakshmi ma'am. Ma'am, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Friends, we are starting a new chapter in human physiology. First chapter you have studied all about digestive system, right? See, we are all multicellular organisms. What are multicellular organisms? Body or the living organism which is made up of many cells. So when we are talking about human beings, you know the number of cells. How can the number be? It can be around more than trillions and trillions. So what is the specialty of these multicellular organisms? Yes, can anyone say? Can you think? Advantage of multicellular organisms? You find over here division of labor. That means we know that cells form tissues, tissues into organs, organs into organ systems. So each and every organ system, it does its own work. So digestive system, you have learned very recently, its work is to digest the food. So it is not bothered what respiratory system is doing, whether oxygen is going and not going. No, its work is only to digest the food, take the food, break down into simple molecules. So like this, you find division of labor because of these organ systems. So first chapter was with digestive system. So human physiology, this chapter that I'm going to talk, this is about excretory system. Friends, this is the fourth chapter actually in your textbook. So second chapter is regarding respiratory system. The third one, circulatory, followed by that is this system. So without getting wasting time, sorry, let's get started. Friends, now the topics covered in this particular session, we are going to learn actually what is excretion, why nitrogenous waste are produced, what are the different types of waste produced, what are the different types of structures that you find in organisms which help in eliminating this system, and finally learn about our own system and if there are any disorders, how to rectify them. Out of so many topics that I mentioned in the previous slide, in today's session, we are not going to cover all the topics what I mentioned. So we are going to deal with the first three important things: definition, types of nitrogenous waste, and first of all, why they are produced. Friends, from IPE point of view, maybe only one question or no question might appear. But I'm going a little behind the textbook to give you so that some input, extra input, which will be helpful for you in understanding basic concepts. Okay, what is it that you are able to see in your first slide? I'm sure you can identify, you could have identified. This is a picture of any factory, right? What is done in factories? Certainly things are produced. What is it that you can see coming out through the chimneys? It is all smoke. Is smoke part of that factory? Yes, it is actually a waste material that is produced. That means whenever things are manufactured, you find definitely there is generation of waste material. Let me go on to the second one. What is this slide which is there showing? You can see actually all the domestic chores which take place at home. Sweeping the floor, putting the dust into the dustbin, washing, cleaning, all those things. How many of you really help your mothers in doing this? And boys, don't think that this is the job of only girls. In today's world, everybody is equal. So even you need to do all these activities at home to help your mother, your sister, or in future, your spouses also. Friends, why do we sweep the floor? Today I swept. Why should I sweep tomorrow again? Obviously, I stay today at home, so I'm doing a lot of work. Because of activities being done, there is a lot of garbage produced. Example, if I'm sitting and learning, unwanted papers, maybe scribbled papers, or I sharpen my pencil, used up plastic refills, whatever it is, everything goes into waste. Same case if you are talking about kitchen, vegetables, fruits, all these things are a part of our life. Suppose if I don't clean my house today, what will happen? My house will get filled up with only rubbish and garbage. Can I survive with all those filth around me? No. What will happen? Sure, you know the answer. You find germs breeding over there. They enter into your living things. And finally, you get sick. So do you know why I showed you the first slide? I'm rolling back to first slide. First slide, I have shown you a picture of a factory saying that in factories, things are produced. Right from the products of nanotechnology to needle to big machines, things are produced. And here you find lot of waste material produced even at home. So what we are trying to understand is wherever activities go on, you find there is production or generation of waste material. Wherever things go on, there is waste generated. It is a part of that activity. And the waste should be eliminated continuously. Now, so much I'm talking about waste generation. Why should I talk about it when I'm talking about human physiology? Because even our body is like a house. Even our body is like a factory. You find all our important, priceless organs in our body doing immense job. So what are the activities that go on in our body? We call all these activities, all the reactions that take place in our body are our activities. Can you name the term which describes all these activities? You have come across this term in your first lesson, first answer of your first year. Define metabolism. Do you know that? Did you recollect this term? So all the activities that take place in our body, we call all those activities as metabolic activities, metabolism. So metabolism is once again divided into two steps or two types: catabolic, catabolism, and anabolism. So what constitutes catabolism? If a big molecule is broken down, you get small molecules. So that is catabolism, catabolic reactions. In anabolism, simple molecules, they join together and new molecules are made. Synthesis of new molecules is called anabolism. So catabolism and anabolism together constitutes metabolism. And whenever we are saying there is a lot of activity going on in our body, we mean by this term metabolism. So these metabolic activities produce waste in our body, and these waste should be eliminated. Otherwise, what will happen? Obviously, all these are fatal. They cause death. Now, let's look at some of the waste that are generated in our body. See, you can think about the waste generated at your home. There is liquid waste, there is solid waste, there is gaseous waste. Similarly, in our body also, all the waste can be classified as solid waste, liquid waste, and gaseous waste. So what is the solid waste, friends, that you can see? Yes, solid waste over here is feces. The other day you finished about digestive system, right? So what is this feces? Another name for feces is stool. Undigested food material which goes out of the body through anus, that is solid waste. Liquid waste, we have liquid, two types of liquids which are actually waste. One is sweat, the other one is urine. So sweat is produced by our skin. Then if you are talking about urine is another liquid waste which should be eliminated out, and it is sent out through urethra opening. What about the gaseous waste then? Gaseous waste is nothing but carbon dioxide. Now friends, if you look at the systems that I mentioned over here, digestive system's main work is not to send waste material out. Its main work is something else, taking the food, breaking down into simple molecules and giving it to blood, absorption. Whereas if you are talking about skin is the largest organ of our body. It protects our body. Its functions are different. Same case with respiratory system, taking in of oxygen, that is its main work. Apart from these main things, they are also doing the extra job of removing the waste that are generated. So they are doing that extra job. They are not main excretory organs. Waste things, they are just throwing out. But when we are talking about kidneys, friends, here, actually I should not have mentioned, but for your understanding, I mentioned over here, kidneys are very, very important excretory organs about which we are going to learn in this particular unit. Now, as I mentioned, that digestive system, you have already learned in depth about this. You have over here, there is a structure which is called rectum, where solid feces is stored, and then it is sent out through opening called anus, right? Respiratory system, you find over from here, carbon dioxide being sent out by the lungs, and the air goes out, CO2 is sent out through this external nostrils. Skin, another important organ, and you find over here sweat glands which produce sweat, and the sweat gets eliminated from here. Now, let me talk about most important thing, and that is kidneys excreting waste material, which is urine. Friends, composition of urine, as you can see on your screen, it constitutes water, 96%. Dear students, when we are talking about these percentages, they are all in averages. Some textbooks you may find water as 96 to 98, like this. So these are not averages that we are talking about. Next, organic substances. You have organic substances, you have inorganic solutes, and waste material growing out even over here. You can see something being mentioned called as drugs. If at all you're on some kind of medication, extra medicines are also thrown out through this urine only. What is the difference between this organic substances and inorganic solutes? Right? Can anyone say this? So solute is a substance which get dissolved in any solvent. And these are all organic substances. These are also solutes which get dissolved in water, which is a solvent. The difference between organic substances and inorganic substances, friends, organic substances have carbon and hydrogen bonds, whereas you don't find in inorganic substances those bonds. Even if carbon is present, you don't find hydrogen being attached to it. So this is the main difference between organic molecules and inorganic molecules. Now, let me come back to the word composition of urine. So what is urine having over here? Water. Inside this water, all these things are dissolved. Now, special concentration to this word, urea, uric acid, creatine, creatinine. These are all the main waste that should be sent out of the body. Then water-soluble vitamins. You find even some of us pronouncing this word as vitamins. Friends, vitamins are of two types. You have learned in 10th class, right? Water-soluble vitamins and fat-soluble vitamins. Since it is water which is a solvent, extra vitamins which are not used by the body, water-soluble vitamins, nothing but B, vitamin B, B complex, and C. These extra vitamins are also sent out. Hormones. Endocrine glands produce secretions which are called hormones. So extra hormones which our body doesn't use, they are also sent out. Oxalates. Oxalates are organic molecules that enter your body. Usually they are sent out through feces. They bind to calcium. They are sent out through feces in stool. But if at all not from there, then they get dissolved in water and from here it gets eliminated out. Sorry. Inorganic solutes, you find sodium, potassium, magnesium, all these are the inorganic substances. So this is the composition of urine. Now, when you see all these things, nitrogenous substances and all, they are very dangerous, friends. The process, now definition of excretion. As I mentioned that we are going to study excretory system over here. So we have to first define excretion. What is excretion? The elimination or removal of nitrogenous waste material from our body is called excretion. Look at the word nitrogenous. This is very, very important. Nitrogenous waste. Why I said nitrogenous waste? Because even the other things are getting eliminated out. CO2 is getting eliminated out. We have seen feces getting eliminated out. We have seen waste material coming out, sweat getting eliminated out. But when you are saying excretion, it is a special term meant here for nitrogenous waste products. Remember this. Yeah. What is this picture doing over here? Slide doing over here in our excretion. Nice, no? You have money, you can win over the world, right? Money, money, money. It's so funny. Friends, here you can find currency of different nations. Suppose if I take Indian rupees to US, can I buy things over there? No. Because what runs over there? What is in vogue? What is in use? Dollars. Similarly, if I go to UK, I need pounds. So depending on the nation, currency is used, right? Where depending on the nation, wherever you're living, different type of currencies are used. Accordingly, you find nitrogenous waste material are also not uniform. There are different types of nitrogenous waste material produced by living organisms. What are the different types of nitrogenous waste material? As you can see on your screen, most important, first three are mentioned, ammonia, urea, uric acid. These are the three most primary nitrogenous waste produced by living organisms. In one living organism, all the three are not produced. Which is produced? It depends upon the situation. As I told you, currency, it depends upon the nation. So in the same way, what type of waste material, whether it is ammonia which should be produced, whether it should be urea which should be produced, or uric acid, what type of waste is produced by the living organism, it depends upon situation. What are the situations that we are talking about? Evolutionary aspect and how its habitat, mode of life, and whether it is aquatic, terrestrial, all these things are important. Evolutionary aspect, aquatic life, terrestrial life, mode of life, habitat. So depending on the need, necessity to conserve water, these are the situations depending on which this particular waste material is generated. Now, as I told, these are the first three important things, ammonia, urea, uric acid. Apart from those three, There are other nitrogenous waste also which are produced in living things. What are they? Allantoin, hippuric acid, creatine, creatinine. These are the waste materials. And these other waste, as I mentioned, friends, those are specially found in human beings and reptiles. Friends, whether it is, I'm going back to old slide once again, whether it is ammonia, urea, or uric acid, whatever it is. Remember, whatever it is, first thing is that in all the cases, whichever product nitrogenous waste it is, in all the cases, it is first amino group which gets converted into ammonia. So ammonia is a primary product in every type of nitrogenous waste that is produced. Hope you understood what I'm saying. In all the cases, you find amino group getting converted first into ammonia. So ammonia is the primary product that is formed in every living organism as nitrogenous waste product. Later on, according to organism's need, ammonia can either be converted into urea or it is converted into uric acid. But in all the three cases, first product that is formed is ammonia. So ammonia later on gets converted into other things. Hope you understood this particular slide. Moving on. Yes, I'm rolling back once again, friends. Look at this, what I told you. It is ammonia or urea, uric acid, right? So let's look at this. What is the main criteria depending on which organisms decide what their body should be producing waste material? Whether their body should develop ammonia, whether they should generate urea or uric acid. What is the main thing or main criteria that is responsible? That is nothing but water. You can see over here, there are three different containers, right? So over here, this is a 500 ml jar. Obviously, you can find here quantity of water would be more than this 50 ml. And then over here, negligible or least amount of water in this 10 ml, right? So those organisms which don't want to waste water, they can spend only 10 ml of water for sending the waste material out. Some of the organisms, they can afford to send little more water. So they can spend around 50 ml to send waste material out. Some can spend lot of water in sending the waste material out. So amount of water is very crucial in deciding whether they should become ammonotelic, ureotelic, or uricotelic. Now, friends, I'm talking about so much nitrogenous waste are produced, right? First of all, why these nitrogenous waste are produced? Why should they be produced so that they are thrown out of the body? As I told you, because of metabolic activities. Out of all these metabolic activities, again, why nitrogenous? We have already studied in digestive system, what are the final products of digestion? Remember, friends, we need six important nutrients: carbohydrates, fats, proteins, vitamins, minerals, water. No digestion takes place for vitamins, minerals, water, because these three are used directly by the body. But if you are talking about carbohydrates, fats, and proteins, what happens to carbohydrates? Any type of carbohydrate that you take, it gets converted into glucose. Similarly, any type of protein you take, final product of protein metabolism, it is amino acid. Fats, they are fatty acids and glycerol. So here, proteins are converted into amino acids, right? So we are taking proteins through our food and that is getting converted into or digested to amino acids. Now, unused, what are these amino acids used in our body for? For forming new proteins in our body. Our body inside makes use of these amino acids to form new proteins according to their need, according to their necessity. Now, let me talk about some of the examples of proteins produced in our body. You find albumin, that's a protein that you find it in plasma, blood plasma. Then you find fibrinogen, which plays an important role in clotting of the blood. You have collagen, very important protein that forms a most important constituent of your fibrous cartilage. Then you find melanin, keratin. These are all different proteins. From where does our body generate all these proteins? Inside our body, through the proteins that you take. So you are taking proteins in your body, they are getting converted into amino acids. Now, according to your need, your body will generate new proteins from these amino acids. What about the amino acids which your body doesn't need? Unused amino acids, your body don't need them. What should you do with those amino acids? Those amino acids only are converted into nitrogenous products. So first of all, from where are these amino acids coming? Unused, unwanted amino acids in your body through the food that you're taking. See, when you, for example, that I'm taking an apple. I cannot select which amino acid is important in that and segregate outside and take. I take apple as a whole thing while eating. So inside, maybe while eating, I'm taking unused or unwanted amino acids. So they should be thrown out. That is what later on forms nitrogenous waste material. So similarly, because of internal processes, also a lot of amino acids are produced. These amino acids, our body don't need them. They should be thrown out of the body. So that is where the nitrogenous waste are produced. Apart from these amino acids, breakdown of nucleic acids also produces these nitrogenous waste. So finally, you have understood, I hope, why nitrogenous waste are produced. In short, I'm saying once again, proteins that you take through food, they are getting converted into amino acids. So used amino acids, our body uses them, sorry, amino acids are used for producing different types of proteins as per your body need requirement. Unused amino acids, our body don't need them. They are converted into nitrogenous waste material and they should be sent out. Apart from the food, there are a lot of activities going on in your body that also generates amino acids, which might not be a part of your body and should be thrown out. That is where this nitrogenous waste are produced. Friends, now the process of, if you look at this particular slide, as I told you, I'm rolling back to old slide, please don't get confused. What did I tell over here? That anything is there, first you find here ammonia, formation of ammonia. Ammonia gets converted into urea, uric acid, etc. So let us try to understand how is this ammonia formed first. So this, if you look at this particular structure slide, friends, you can understand the formation of ammonia. In case of lower organisms, aquatic organisms, every cell produces ammonia. Other than important, some of the important organs like heart and brain, every cell, for example, we are talking about amoeba, single celled organism, it can produce ammonia. If you are talking about hydra, it can produce ammonia. Every cell in hydra can produce ammonia. Like that, every cell in living organisms can produce ammonia. But if you are talking about vertebrates, like human beings, so where is that ammonia produced? It is produced here in this structure. Did you recognize the structure, friends? What is this? You have learned. Once again, see, every time I'm giving you the reference of digestive system, because recently your teachers have taught you digestive system, right? So hope you recognize this particular organ. This is nothing but liver. So in vertebrates, you find in liver that ammonia is produced. Where is ammonia produced? It is produced in liver, in vertebrates. Now the process of production of ammonia, we call it as oxidative deamination. What do we mean by the word deamination? Amination, amina, amino acid, de removal. That means we are removing amino group from amino acids. which amino acids which we don't need, which we don't need from those amino acids. Friends, you can see here two structures. Here, chemical formula is given and the same thing is repeated over here, right? This is a general formula of amino acid. You find over here carbon, and you know carbon has got four bonds. So on one side, you are having this NH2. This NH2 is the one that I am referring to, amino group, this one. This is poisonous. So in unused amino acids, this amino group is not needed by our bodies. What happens to this rest of the things, the COOH, your carboxyl group, hydrogen, another, this rest of the material over here, which you can see from the amino acids, this one is converted into carbohydrates and it is stored in our body, right? So from amino acids which are not used by our body, amino group is made to get separated and rest of the things, this one is converted into carbohydrates and it is stored in our body. So what is happening over here to this amino group, this NH2, it takes up one proton, that is hydrogen plus, and then it becomes ammonia. So NH2, please pay attention what I'm saying. NH2 amino group, it takes up or gets added up to one proton, that is hydrogen plus. So NH2 plus H plus, it gives rise to ammonia, NH3. So here the first product that is formed is ammonia. So this work is, it takes place here in liver. So in liver, you find this process of deamination going on. I'm sure you have already learned. See, liver is one most important, another important organ of our body. In the previous slides where I was showing, I did not talk about liver, but liver is the one which is actually producing waste material in vertebrates. When you think about excretory system, you people are not dumb. You already know that kidneys eliminate waste. Kidneys are filtering waste material and sending out of the body. But production of that waste material, where is it taking place? It is taking place here in liver. Liver is called as angel guard of our body, angel organ of our body, very vital organ. So this is the one which is actually producing waste nitrogenous material. What is the process called? It is called oxidative deamination. By this process, it is sent out. Clear? Whereas, this is in case of vertebrates, friends. But if you're talking about lower organisms, in each and every cell, ammonia is directly produced from these amino acids, amino group. One amino group is separated. It takes up one proton, becomes ammonia directly. And it is sent out. This is how ammonia is produced. So, what happens if ammonia is formed? Okay, we can say, so what? Amino acids are there. We are taking proteins, amino acids are produced. So what if amino acids are not used? Why can't they stay in our body? I told you, no? Suppose you are having a lot of garbage in your house. Can you survive with garbage? No. This ammonia is also like garbage to cell. It is highly toxic, highly poisonous substance. Ammonia causes burning sensation and irritation. Cells die. The minute they are formed in the body, they should be sent out of the cell. Otherwise, cell dies. That is the reason ammonia is highly toxic material to be eliminated out. Now, what is the next one over here? Okay, let's try to understand the other feature. Solubility. Ammonia is highly soluble in water. Highly soluble in water. And you just try to calculate what I'm saying. 1 gram of ammonia needs 300 to 500 ml of water to be sent out. So suppose if I am a living thing, my body is producing 1 gram of ammonia. That 1 gram of ammonia at a given time, if it has to go out, this should get dissolved in water, then only it can be sent out. So water is needed to send this nitrogenous waste material out. Once again, I'm saying, water is needed to send the nitrogenous waste material out of the body. How much water? When you are talking about ammonia, 1 gram of ammonia needs 300 to 500 ml, half liter water to go out. Now, suppose you just calculate, in a day, a body produces 20 grams of ammonia. So 20 into 500, how many liters of water is needed by that organism to send the waste material out? Hope you understood the connection, friends. Now, try to understand whatever I have taught and connect it with the question that I asked over there. Why only aquatic organisms eliminate ammonia? Most of the times you find aquatic organisms which are living in water, only they can eliminate ammonia. Why? Hope you got the answer. Because only they can afford to spend that much of water from their body. Friends, let me give you one example. On what characteristic feature this is dependent on? I showed you previously one slide of jars, measuring jars, 10 ml, 50 ml, 500 ml, right? So organism is able to spend more amount from its body in sending the waste material out, then they can produce ammonia and send ammonia directly out. If organisms don't have water for themselves, for their needs, they cannot afford to spend more water from their bodies to send ammonia out. So what they do, they try to convert ammonia into the next substance. And the third type, they don't want to give even that little water. So nitrogenous type depends upon the availability of water. Let me try to give you an analogy to make you understand this. Can you and I, normal people, go for buying big choppers, helicopters? No. Why? Because we need to have a lot of money, right? Only business people can do that. Very rich people can buy because they are surrounded by money. Now let's talk about cars. Some middle class people, higher middle class people, they can buy cars. But if you're talking about people who are living in the streets, it's difficult for them to meet their both ends. Do you think that they'll think about cars, vehicles and all? No, it is not possible. Similarly, these organisms, in order to send the waste material out of the body, they have to spend water from their bodies. So this nitrogenous waste material dissolves in water and then only it can go out. It will not go out just like that. So how much water should be available for ammonia? For 1 gram, it is 500 ml of water. Now, normal living things which are living on land, they cannot spend that much water. So ammonia is the nitrogenous product only. You can find it in aquatic organisms because they are living in water. How much ever water they want, they can take. And they can send waste material out. So only they can produce waste material. Hope you got the question over, answer for this question over here. Why only aquatic organisms eliminate ammonia? Now, here, ammonotelism. What is this? The process of removal of nitrogenous waste in the form of ammonia is called ammonotelism. Friends, in future slides, I am not going to give definitions for all the things. I want you to write definitions, seeing this as an example. So what is ammonotelism? Ammonotelism means the process of removal of nitrogenous waste in the form of ammonia. So nitrogenous product is ammonia. So that process is ammonotelism. What is this over here? Just give me friends. Ammonotelic. The organisms which eliminate ammonia from their bodies, they are called as ammonotelic. Ammonotelism, it is process. Ammonotelic, it is organism. Ammonotelic means organism. Ammonotelism, it is process. The process of elimination of nitrogenous waste in the form of ammonia. So what are all the examples you can find? As I mentioned earlier, all aquatic organisms. So amoeba, hydra, once again, friends, this is structure of amoeba. You find this living in organism, single-celled organism. It excretes waste material in the form of ammonia. Hydra, again, marine organism, excreting waste material in the form of ammonia. Bony fishes. Friends, you remember, in your fourth chapter, first year, you had one answer, one very important question. Differentiate between osteichthyes and chondrichthyes. That is nothing but differences between bony fishes and cartilaginous fishes, right? So bony fishes where the endoskeleton is made up of bones. So these bony fishes also excrete ammonia. What are the examples so far we have studied, friends? All aquatic organisms are ammonotelic, whether it is single-celled ammonia, amoeba, multicellular hydra, all these are multicellular organisms, or bony fishes, very big vertebrates. These are all ammonotelic. That means these are all aquatic organisms which have the ability to spend water to send the waste material out. Friends, so far we have completed first part of this excretory system. What we have learned, let me recapitulate very quickly. I'm rolling back all the slides. Let us recapitulate very, very quickly whatever we have learned before we go further to further slides. Every system generates waste. Our body also generates waste. They should be thrown out. So what are all the waste materials generated in our body? Friends, intentionally, I did not give over here, but liver is also very important organ. We'll study about it once again. But these are all the waste materials which are produced in our body. So some of them, these are all the, waste material generated. Most important waste material is nitrogenous waste material. So elimination of nitrogenous waste material is called excretion. Now, all the living organisms don't produce the same type of nitrogenous product. Nitrogenous product depends upon the amount of the water that these organisms can actually spend to send this waste material out. So now here you can see urea, friends, needs 50 ml of water. 1 gram of urea needs 50 ml of water to be sent out. Uric acid, you can see over here, uric acid needs only 10 ml to be sent out. Whereas if you are talking about ammonia, highly dangerous, highly toxic substance, this is highly soluble in water and it needs 500 ml to be sent out. So now, why nitrogenous waste are produced? I already taught you. Proteins metabolism produces amino acids. Amino acids which are not used by our body, either taken internally through food or because of the internal processes that they are produced, because of these amino acids and even nucleic acids. I'll talk about nucleic acids later on. From these unused things, nitrogenous waste products are produced. Now, the process by which this ammonia is produced, that is called oxidative deamination. In aquatic organisms, lower aquatic organisms, every cell can produce ammonia. But if you are talking about vertebrates, you find that ammonia is produced especially in this particular organ called the liver. The process is called oxidative deamination. Any nitrogenous waste product, let it be first product that is formed is ammonia. Ammonia should be formed. So ammonia, amino acid, amino acid. When you look at this, the formula of this is, there is carbon atom over here, and there are four important bonds, and you find molecules attached to these four bonds. So here, when you look at this group NH2, similarly, same thing over here, friends, NH2, NH and H. This should be separated. This separation of amino group from the rest of the amino acid is called oxidative deamination. This takes place in liver. Because of this, now this amino group NH2, it takes up one proton, becomes ammonia. Once it becomes ammonia, cell cannot handle that ammonia because it is toxic, highly poisonous. So it should be immediately sent out. But will that ammonia go on its own out? No, it needs 500 ml of water to go out. And any living thing cannot retain ammonia. Immediately it should go out. Otherwise it causes burning sensation, irritation, and it kills the cell. So these are the characteristic features. As I told you earlier, toxicity, I finished telling you, highly toxic. It needs 500 ml of water to dissolve. Ammonotelism, ammonia is a nitrogenous product. Ammonotelism, the process of removal of nitrogenous waste material in the form of ammonia is called ammonotelism. You should know to differentiate between ammonotelism and ammonotelic. Ammonotelism is a process, ammonotelic is organism. So who can actually afford to send waste material in the form of ammonia? It is only aquatic organisms, because they are surrounded by water. They can only use water to send this waste material out. So you can find over here, amoeba, hydra, bony fishes. These are all ammonotelic organisms. Okay, friends. Once we have understood ammonotelism, let's move on to the next part of this excretory system and understand another concept in this, which is ureotelism. Friends, now can you define ureotelism? I showed you ammonotelism. Now what is ureotelism? Please take down the definition. If you are able to write on your own, it's fine. The process of eliminating nitrogenous waste material in the form of urea is called ureotelism. I'm repeating again. The process of eliminating nitrogenous waste material in the form of urea is called ureotelism. So obviously, what is the waste material? As I mentioned, it is urea. Now the cycle, right? The chain of reaction that I'm talking about, how this urea is produced. We call it as urea cycle, or it is also called as ornithine cycle, or it is called as Krebs-Hensley cycle. These are the terms given to them. Ornithine cycle, friends, we'll study in detail afterwards. We'll definitely have a look into this. But right now, you remember what it is, the name. Now, what is this next term, ureotelic? I'm rolling back the slide. What is this ammonotelic that you have learned? The organisms which eliminate ammonia from their bodies as waste, right? So here, what will be ureotelic? The organisms which send urea as their nitrogenous waste product, they are called ureotelic. Once again, the organisms which eliminate urea as a nitrogenous waste material are called ureotelic. In what way this ureotelic or ureotelism is advantageous to terrestrial organisms? Little while ago, what did I tell you? I asked you one question on ammonia, right? Why is it that only aquatic organisms can be ammonotelic? So if you find answer for that, you can get to know answers for this question also. Advantages to terrestrial organisms. How is this ureotelism important to terrestrial organisms? Friends, when we discussed ammonia, what did we learn? It is highly toxic and cell cannot bear it. Immediately, it should send out of the body. Ammonia should be immediately sent out. Not less than 1 second, it should go off. It is like that. But if you are talking about urea as nitrogenous waste, its toxicity, poisonous nature is around 1 lakh times less than that of ammonia. Did you get it? Toxicity, poisonous nature of urea. It is 1 lakh times lesser than that of ammonia. So ammonia can go out, it should be sent out immediately. But urea can be made to stay in the cells in the body for some time. They can be made to retain for some time because of their less toxic nature. This is one thing. Second thing, if urea has to go out of the body, urea doesn't take all the water, consume all the water and go out. How much water it needs? 50 ml water, that's it. It is only 50 ml water. So this is the advantage why terrestrial organisms like us living on land, which you find living on land, amphibians, they are all ureotelic organisms. What is the advantage? Advantage is that they need less water to be sent out, only around 50 ml for 1 gram, and its toxicity, that is, it is not fatal. It can stay in living things for some time. But what is the demerit? What is the disadvantage if you are talking about ureotelism? Demerit is that it needs energy. That means ATP is spent here. Energy currency is spent here. Even though energy is spent, still terrestrial organisms feel that spending energy is better than losing water. That is the reason they have adjusted and adapted this mode or this method. Now, as I mentioned, now where is this urea produced? Urea is produced once again in case of vertebrates. It is found in liver. It is produced in liver. What are the examples for this ureotelism? Mammals, elasmobranchs or cartilaginous fishes. These are the examples. Friends, look at this slide, ornithine cycle. In detail, we are going to learn about this cycle later on. But here you understand one basic thing. You remember I told you whatever it is, whichever nitrogenous product that you talk about, the first thing that is produced is no doubt ammonia. So in liver only, in human beings also, first thing, because of oxidative deamination, that is ammonia group is removed, it is added to one hydrogen proton, right? And then it becomes ammonia. This ammonia takes up carbon dioxide and it is converted into urea. This is ornithine cycle, urea cycle, or hence Krebs-Hensley cycle. So this is how urea is produced. Once again, friends, in the liver only ammonia is formed. In case of human beings and terrestrial organisms, first ammonia is formed by oxidative deamination process. This ammonia then gets added up to carbon dioxide molecule and then it is becoming urea. So where is this nitrogenous waste produced? Actually, it is produced in urea. Who is sending out of it, out of our body? It is kidneys, excretory system. But production is taking place, its generation is taking place here in liver. Now, when you look at the formula of urea, it is this. CONH2 taken twice over here. This is how you find urea crystals, just like sugar crystals. Now, these are the examples, ureotelic examples, elasmobranchs, cartilaginous fissures. Friends, cartilaginous fissures, elasmobranchs. Endoskeleton of these fissures is made up of cartilage. Endoskeleton of these fissures, they are all made up of cartilages. These fissures are called as ray fissures. So you find torpedoes, electric ray fish, all these fissures are cartilaginous fissures, jaws that you talk about, all these fissures. mammals, all mammals, we are all ureotelic, including human beings. Including human beings, we are all ureotelic. So what did we learn over here about ureotelism? I'm repeating about ureotelism. The process of removing waste material, that is nitrogenous waste material, in the form of urea is called ureotelism. So urea is a nitrogenous waste material. What is ureotelic? Organism which is producing urea as its nitrogenous waste material, that organism is ureotelic. So where is this urea produced? It is produced in liver. What is the process called? We call it as Ornithine cycle, urea cycle, or Krebs-Hensley cycle. What is the advantage? Actually, in this case, urea is less poisonous than ammonia. How many times? 1 lakh times. It is less poisonous. So it can stay in cell after its formation for some time. And how much water it needs to be sent out? Very less, minimum water, that is 50 ml. That is the reason terrestrial organisms which don't get water continuously, they can't get water continuously, so they cannot afford to use it in sending waste material out. Hence, they have adapted to this mode of sending the waste material. That is, they have become ureotelic. So what is the Ornithine cycle, if you want to talk about it in one single equation or cycle? Ammonia reacts with carbon dioxide to form urea and water. Blood carries this urea to kidneys, and kidneys filter it and send it out. Production is taking place in liver. Elimination is taking place through excretory system, that is through kidney, going out through urethra in the form of urine. One more point over here. Formation of ammonia is also taking place in liver through oxidative deamination process. Then this ammonia takes carbon dioxide, gets converted to urea. What is the formula of urea, friends? It's given over here. CONH2 taken twice. You can find over here its appearance. Urea appears like this. So examples, elasmobranchs or cartilaginous fishes. So friends, elasmobranchs plural can be CHES also towards the end. Elasmobranchs, you can find over here CHES also plural. So mammals, we are all ureotelic. What does your body produce nitrogenous waste material as? Ammonia or urea finally? First it is ammonia, then getting converted into urea. Very good. Now let's move on to the third mode of nitrogenous waste material that is produced, that is ureotelism. Friends, I taught you ammonotelism, I taught you ureotelism. So I think you should be writing definition now on your own. What is ureotelism? Ureotelism means process. What process? Sending out the waste material. Which waste material? Nitrogenous. In which form? Uric acid. The process of removing uric acid as a nitrogenous waste material from the body is ureotelism. Who are ureotelic? Organisms which send waste material out in the form of uric acid are ureotelic. So differentiate between ureotelism and ureotelic. What is telism and telic? Telism means process. Telic means organism. Now, this is very complex process, friends. Ureotelism is highly complex process for us to understand. Where is this uric acid produced? Uric acid is produced in case of vertebrates in liver, and a little amount is produced even in kidneys. Kidney also produces uric acid. What is the advantage of ureotelism? We have studied about ureotelism. It is less toxic, 1 lakh times toxic than ammonia. So uric acid is least toxic of all the three. And it can be comfortably made to stay in the cell though it is waste material, for comparable amount of time, considerable amount of time. So it is least toxic. And when we talk about spending water to send it out, it needs the least amount of water or negligible amount of water. How much? 1 gram needs only 10 ml. So organisms which don't get water for themselves, for their daily activities, their metabolic activities, who don't want to spend water on waste material, so for them, this is a boon. This uricotelism is a boon. Where do you find this uricotelism? In birds. Birds are uricotelic. Another thing, friends, we know that birds are flying mammals. Flying organisms. So if they store waste material along with water, that would add even to their weight while flying. So why to carry that extra weight? Not needed. Now, why is this picture over here? Let me roll back to the previous slide. Look at this. What did I give over here? Kidney, right? Uric acid is also produced in kidney. So here, friends, if kidney is producing waste material, then you find that waste material is actually excreted in solution form. It goes out in solution form. Again, birds cannot think of sending anything in liquid form. So once that waste material is excreted, it reaches this common chamber, which we call it as cloaca. I think you have learned already in your first year about cloaca. This is a common chamber which receives material from three different systems. Digestive system, then you find material coming from excretory system as well as from reproductive system. So here, once kidneys send solution over here in cloaca, all that water is taken back by cloaca. And finally, uric acid is sent out, which is in the form of semi-paste kind of thing or uric acid crystals. You can see all these are birds droppings in this picture. What are all these, friends? Birds droppings. When you look at birds droppings, you find colored material and white material. Colored material is feces, that is undigested food material. Along with that, you find waste, white material. That white material is uric acid. That is a nitrogenous waste material. So that uric acid, which is given by these organisms, it is collected by human beings for their commercial purpose, which is called as guano. So from that, uric acid is prepared. Uricotelic, you have already learned about cockroach in detail, and we have studied that cockroach, you find malpighian tubules which excrete the waste material out in the form of uric acid, where almost pellets come out. That means, imagine, friends, from these organisms, urine is coming out in the form of pellets, not in liquid form or very less liquid. Uricotelic, these are snails, other reptiles, which are uricotelic organisms. What is the formula of uric acid? C5H4N4O3. Please take down uric acid formula, C5H4N4O3. Uric acid crystals, appearance wise, they are like this. Uric acid crystals. Okay. Though majority to a larger extent, we produce urea as a waste material, in human beings, some amount of uric acid is produced. We human beings also produce uric acid as waste material, but in very less quantity. So from where is this nucleic acid produced? Because of the breakdown of nucleic acids. You will study in detail about nucleic acids, but I'm sure you must be having idea about DNA and RNA. So when these nucleic acids break down, especially from purines, you have something called purines, pyrimidines. So their breakdown, especially adenine and guanine, they break down and they become xanthin. From xanthin, uric acid is produced. So human beings are first ureotelic, but in less quantities, even uric acid is produced. Now, in some cases, friends, uric acid that is produced in human beings, suppose it gets deposited near joints, whether it is elbows or joints of toes, knees, etc. If uric acid deposition takes place, it causes a disorder, which we call it as gout. You can see in this particular picture, uric acid crystals, those are nothing, that is nothing but uric acid crystal, and the disorder is gout. Then we have studied ammonotelism, ureotelism, uricotelism. This part, there is something called dual excretion, friends. This is not there in your textbook, but you can just have a look at it. Dual excretion means there are certain organisms which have the ability to produce nitrogenous waste material depending on the amount of water they are surrounded by. Right? Did you all understand? Dual excretion means organisms have the capacity to produce nitrogenous waste depending on the amount of water that they are surrounded by. So if you are talking about examples, tadpoles, they are in water, so they are ammonotelic. But frog, it lives on land, so it is ureotelic. Earthworms, when they have lot of water, they are ammonotelic. If they don't have water, then they become ureotelic. Crocodiles, when they are in water, they produce ammonotelic. They are ammonotelic animals. But if they come out of water and stay for longer period of time on land, then suddenly they switch over to ureotelism or uricotelism also. Similarly, you have over here African lungfish. This one is African lungfish, friends. And this is Xenopus. This is African toad. These organisms, they are aquatic organisms, they are ammonotelic, but again, depending on the need, they can become ureo or urico. Friends, the last one over here, another type, we have studied ammonotelism, ureo, urico, we have studied dual excretion. Aminotelism means some organisms, they don't get involved in all this process of conversion and all those things. Whatever directly amino acid is produced, they send directly unused amino acid out of the body. That means it is excretion of unused amino acids without any conversion. They are eliminated out. So that process is aminotelism. Now, examples where you can find in some mollusks and echinoderms. So this is a summary of whatever we have learned, friends. Ammonotelism and ureotelism. Look at this. First you have amino group, NH2 group coming from every amino acid. So when proteins are broken down, you get amino acids converted into amino groups. Similarly, when nucleic acids are broken down, that is DNA, RNA, you get amino groups. This amino group, first thing is that it is converted into ammonia. Here, lot of water is there, then organisms can excrete ammonia out. Then If organisms are not able to use lot of water in sending waste, ammonia gets converted into urea. From ammonia, urea is produced. Similarly, from ammonia, some organisms don't even want to spend 50 ml, not even 10 ml. Then they are uricotelic organisms. Over here, the same thing I have given. Same thing, friends. NH3 ammonia, CONH2 taken twice urea. And this is the big formula of uric acid. Friends, hope you understood whatever I taught. And from examination point of view, please make a note of this particular question. Terrestrial animals are generally either ureotelic or uricotelic and not ammonotelic. Why? Please try to take down this question, answer. Hope you understood my class. If you have further any doubts, any clarifications, you can get back to us. And if possible, you can mail me your questions also. Take down my mail ID. Ma'am, can I give my mail ID? Hello?
Yes.
Jhansi.
Yes.
J-H-A-N-S-I. janshibai.t@gmail.id. So we are done with this session for today, friends. Hope you understood. I just want to revise important points. First thing is that nitrogenous waste products produces waste material. Waste materials are of different types. Depending on the water, they send out. So accordingly, they are ammonotelic.
Yes.
Organisms can be ammono, ureo, or uricotelic. Hope you understood the session.
Yes, ma'am.
Vijayalakshmi,
yes, ma'am. Thanks.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Yeah, thanks, madam. Children, now today, like what you have learned about the different types of nitrogenous waste in different organisms. So tomorrow we'll come up with a new thing for the zoology. This week we have two more classes. So let us continue with the excretory system further. Thank you, madam, for today's talk.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay.